Good morning, everyone. Welcome to visitors and church members alike to our MPC online church service. Trust you have a good time as we come around God's word together this morning and our time of worship. This morning we have a visiting speaker, my dad, Jim McGlade. He's going to be coming and speaking God's word to us. And in a moment, I'm going to hand over to Kate, who's going to do our children's slot. Before we do so, I want to read to you a few a verse of scripture in the Bible. It's from Psalm 119 and verse 96. And it says that I have seen the consummation of all perfection. In other words, to all perfection, I see a limit. But your commandment is exceedingly broad. You know, some translations say to all perfection I see limit, but your commands are boundless. You know, as I was reading those words recently, I thought that when God's word comes into a life, it almost brings some limitations. It requires us to live a narrow path. But the joy of that is that when we live in the limitations of God's word, we actually live a life that is limitless in the impact and the difference it can make in the lives of others and how God can use us. You know, I recently came across a quote by an Australian pastor by the name of Phil Pringle. And he said this, that there is not a problem God has not already provided the answer for. There is not a problem any of us face that is bigger than the God inside of us. And there is not a problem mankind faces that cannot be solved through the complete salvation of the cross of Christ. God, when we walk in God's ways, we can live a limitless life that can make a huge impact in difference to the world around us. I'm going to hand over to Kate, and then we're going to have a short time of worship. See you soon.
Good morning, everyone. I just wanted to ask you another question this morning. Have you ever had to wait for something? Maybe you've had to wait for a bus or a taxi or even an aeroplane if you've been on holiday somewhere to a different country. Maybe you've had to wait in a waiting room to see a doctor. Maybe you've been to a theme park and had to wait in line to get on a ride. Maybe you've had to wait to get something like a special birthday present that you really want or a Christmas present you really want. Or you might have had to wait for your dinner to cook in the oven whilst you're really hungry. My children really don't like waiting for that. Or Sam, for that matter. But I think one of the worst things is when you are young and you want something. Maybe it's a toy or a phone or something else. Or you want to do something like go shopping on your own with friends or going for a sleepover on your own for a very first time at a friend's house. And whatever it is that you want to do, and your parents say this, they say, you have to wait until you're older. I think that is one of the worst things to wait for because you can't have it straight away. I think it probably makes us the most angry and it makes us think that it's just not fair. And there are a lot of times in our lives that we have to wait for things, and a lot of times that we just don't like waiting. When we are waiting for things that we wish we could have straight away or do straight away, we start getting annoyed or tired or we get angry and lots of other very not very nice feelings. And that is because we just don't know why we have to wait, or we're just not used to having to wait. I know everything in the world right now is all about getting things as fast as you can and not having to wait. We have a lot of parcels come to our house at the moment, and most of the time they only take a day or two to arrive. And they can be coming from anywhere in the UK or even further. And it is amazing how you can just click a button on your phone and it turns up to your house a couple of days later. So because we've got so used to being able to do things and have things when we want straight away, like maybe even going to see a family member or a friend or going to a play area or going to play football with our friends or whatever you love to do, we don't like it when we have to wait to be able to do it when we've not had to wait before. And right now it feels like we've been waiting for a long time for this virus to go away. for us to not have any restrictions or rules on where we can go or what we have or what we can do. And it's almost like we're in a waiting room, waiting to be able to do the things that we love again, to see the people that we love again. And this can make us all feel very annoyed again, and I feel very tired and angry, just like when we have to wait for those other things. But when I was thinking about this today, a song that we sing in church came to my mind, and it's a line from the song, and it says, "From age to age he stands," that's God, "and time is in his hands, beginning and the end." And this got me thinking, this means that God has everything, even time, in his hands. He has been from the very beginning of the earth, and he has seen right to the very end of the earth, and even beyond that into what's called eternity, where there's no time at all, and it just goes on forever and ever. And he has got it all in his hands. Even the time of the lockdown that we're in now, he knows. We don't know when it's going to be lifted, but he knows when it's going to be lifted. And that he knows even how long the virus will be something that we have to be aware of. And just like when we're young and our parents are told to tell us to wait until we're older, it's not because your parents are being mean or horrible, even though you might think so at the time. It's because your parents are trying to keep you safe and protect you from things that they know about that maybe you don't understand as a child. They might be trying to teach you something in the meantime, or they might just simply be waiting for you to grow up a bit so you can understand properly. And it's the same for us. At the moment, God's got us in a waiting room in our lives, and we might not understand why we've been in it for so long, or why we've not been able to do things for so long. But God knows everything, and God is not trying to be mean, like what I said about our parents, but he's trying to keep us safe, and he's trying to protect us, and he's trying to teach us things, and he's trying to just wait until we're at that perfect time, because God's timing is absolutely perfect. So when he is ready for us to come out of this lockdown and out of this season in our lives, we will come out of it, and we will be even closer to God. And so during this time in the waiting room, we don't have to just sit there twiddling our thumbs and get bored and annoyed and tired like we normally do. We can ask God what he wants us to learn and what he wants us to do and what he wants us to get closer to, how he wants us to get closer to him. And we can trust that God has it all in his hands. Thank you all for joining me this week, and I will see you next week.
Time is right in the nation. works of power and authority. God's looking for a people who are willing to be counted in His glorious victory.
Thank you, Kate, for sharing that thought for the kids and for the adults as well. I'm going to hand over to my dad in a moment, and before I do so, I'm going to read to you a fairly sizable piece of scripture, the book of Daniel, looking at Daniel chapter 3, and this is going to lead into to the message. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, had made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits and its width was 6 cubits. He set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon, and King Nebuchadnezzar sent word to gather together the satraps, the administrators, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the judges, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image which King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. So the satraps, the administrators, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the judges, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces gathered together for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. They stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then a herald cried aloud, "To you it is commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that the time you hear the sound of the horn, lute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, in the symphony with all kinds of music, you shall fall down and worship the gold image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace." And so at that time, when all the people heard the sound of the horn, flute, harp, and lyre, and the symphony with all kinds of music, all the people, nations, and languages fell down and worshipped the gold image which King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Therefore, at the time, certain Chaldeans came forward and accused the Jews. They spoke and said to King Nebuchadnezzar, "O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree that anyone who hears the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery in symphony with all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the gold image. And whoever does not shall not fall down and worship shall be cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not paid due regard to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the gold image which you have set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar, in a rage and fury, gave the command to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they brought these men before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying to them, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship this gold image which I have set up? Now, if you are ready at the time you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the harp, the lyre, the psaltery, and in symphony with all kinds of music, and you fall down and worship the image which I have made, good. But if you do not worship, you shall be cast immediately into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Who is the God who will deliver you from my hands?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king and said, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury, and the expression on his face changed towards Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He spoke and commanded that they heat the furnace seven times more than it was usually heated. And he commanded certain men of valor who were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. And these men were bound in their coats, their trousers and their turbans and their outer garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's command was urgent and the furnace exceedingly hot, the flame of the fire killed the men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down, bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished. He rose in haste and spoke, saying to his counselors, "Did we not cast three men bound into the midst of the fire?" And they answered and said to the king, "True, O king." And he looked, he answered, "I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the form of the fourth is like that of the Son of God." Then Nebuchadnezzar went near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace, and spoke, saying, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out and come here." Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came from the midst of the fire. And the satraps, administrators, governors, and the king's counselors gathered together, and they saw these men, on whose bodies the fire had no power. The hair of their head was not singed, nor were their garments affected, and the smell of fire was not on them. Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. And they have frustrated the king's word and yielded their bodies, that they would not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I decree that any people, nation, or language which speaks anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut into pieces, and the houses shall be made an ash heap, because there is no other God who can deliver like this." And the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. I'm going to hand over to my dad, who is now going to minister from the scriptures.
Well, good morning, Mansfield. I trust you're all well. And good morning to wherever you may be tuning in this morning. We are certainly living in strange times. I've never known a time like this. But we do believe that our God is in control of the situation. I don't know if you recall, but back in the 70s, there used to be a program that came on BBC One. It was, I suppose, geared mainly for children, but it was called Record Breakers, and it was hosted by a very well-known entertainer by the name of Roy Castle, who himself, incidentally, was a Christian. He really did love his Savior. And the title of the program speaks for itself. It was all about people who broke various records, all sorts of crazy records that we've never even heard of before. But at the end of the program, he always used to sing a song. He got his trumpet out and he blew it, and he sang this song. And I'm going to try to refrain from singing too much of it to you. But it went something like this. Well, in fact, it did go like this. It was dedication. Dedication. Dedication is what you need if you want to be the best, if you want to beat the rest, then dedication is what you need. If you want to be a record breaker, I'm sure many of you will remember that. It was a good program. I have got no hesitation in saying if we want to be the best, and if we want to do the best for our God, the God that we love and the God that we serve, then it's going to take a degree of dedication. And by dedication, I mean that we're all out for God. We are committed to the cause of God. We are determined to obey the commands of God. So if you're going to be the best, if you're going to do the best for God, then dedication is what you need. Now, having said that, Matthew will have read to you from Daniel chapter 3. I love the book of Daniel. And Daniel chapter 3 is especially a favorite passage of scripture of mine. But in that chapter, we read about three guys who were totally committed to God: Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were the names that were given to them by the Babylonians. As one person said, the way to remember those names is make your bed, shake your bed, and into bed to go. Or another way you could put it, your shack, my shack, and a bungalow. And that helps you. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these guys, totally committed to God. Now, some people ask, where was Daniel on this occasion? We just read about the three of them. Daniel is nowhere in sight. Now, we must not read into scripture things that are not there, but I assume that if Daniel had been there on this occasion, he would have done exactly the same as his friends. It could have been that he was on the king's business in some other part of his empire. We don't know, but let's not speculate beyond what is revealed to us in the scripture. But these three guys, I just love them. We are first introduced to them in chapter 1 of the book of Daniel, with Daniel. And it's very interesting that there we see that they would not eat the king's meat. They refused the king's food in chapter 1. And here in chapter 3, we see that they refused to bow to the king's image. Dedication. Dedication is what you need if you're going to be the best, if you're going to beat the rest. Dedication is what you need. They would not bow to the king's image of gold. Incidentally, there's a strong link with chapter 3, that particular image, and the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had in chapter 2, but we won't go into that at the moment. But let's look at this theme of dedication just for a few moments. Their particular dedication. First of all, their dedication to God was put to the test. It really was. It would have been, I imagine, pretty scary. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, he makes a statue of gold, and he invites all the big wigs. Actually, it's there for you to read, and it's been read to you already. But there in verse 2, he then summoned the satraps, the prefects, the governors, all the big wigs. And in verse 5 it says, and he says, as soon as you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, pipes, and all kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image of gold. So once the music plays, on your face, on your knees, bow before this image. But these three guys refused to bow. Now, I wonder if the thought had entered their head, oh, let's just compromise here a little bit. Let's kind of bow down and tie our shoelaces, and we'll know that we're not really bowing before this image of gold. I mean, let's face it. If we don't bow, we're gonna burn. You know, I wonder if thoughts like that came into their thinking. They could have said, "Well, everybody's doing it, so let's do it as well. Why should we put ourselves in harm's way? Let's just do it." But if that temptation did come into their heads, I'm sure it was only momentarily. They refused to bow. They could not do that which God said that they must not do. These three Hebrew boys, boy, you could, once again, you could change their names, and the names that they had here are the Babylonian names. That wasn't their original Hebrew names, but you know, you can change their names, but you cannot change their character. You cannot change their dedication to God. And these three Hebrew boys, they would have known the Ten Commandments. They would have known that God said, "You'll have no other gods before me." You read about it there in the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 3 to 5. "You'll not make unto yourself any graven image. You'll not bow down to them, because I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." And you know, they were just so determined that they were going to obey God. Their dedication was of such a high level that they said, "Come what may, we cannot dishonor our God. We will dedicate our lives to God," even though it was put to the test. We live in how do we interpret that today in our setting? Well, I would say that we live in a world where our dedication to God is put to the test. Here I am, I'm getting on, I'm a septuagenarian, I'm recently turned 71, and I have to tell you, friends, that every day my dedication to my God is put to the test. In many ways, in more way than one. There are plenty of gods out there, friends. There's plenty of gods out there who would like us to bow down to them and do them homage. Our dedication to God, my dedication to God, your dedication to God is put to the test on a daily basis. That's why Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, he says, "Don't let the world around you squeeze you into its mold, but be different to the world." These three Hebrew boys, boy, they passed with flying colors. Yeah, their dedication to God was put to the test. but they pass with flying colors. May that be true of us as well. Secondly, their dedication to God was what got them noticed. Have you noticed that? Their dedication to God was what got them noticed. This world in which we live, it's wonderful, isn't it? The plants, the flowers, the creatures that God has brought into this world are amazing. You may have heard of the chameleon lizard. And what's interesting about this little fella is that it blends in with its surroundings quite easily. And obviously this is dumb because it doesn't want to become a prey to any other animals. And so it just blends in, it changes its skin color, so it just blends in with its surroundings. And once again, these three Hebrew boys, they could have done that. They could have just, well, let's just blend in. Let's just do what everybody else is doing. But they refused to do that, and because of that, literally, they got noticed. Because they were standing when everybody else was bowing. And the enemies which they had in the royal courts, people who were probably jealous of how these three Hebrew boys were elevated in the king's empire, they took notice of it as well, and they went back and they told, you know, hey, Neb, didn't you say that, you know, that once the sound of the music plays, everybody's got to bow down, but you've got three guys who refused to do that. Hey, they literally stood out. Now, I want to say that they stood out like sore thumbs. Let me read to you what it says in Peter's epistle, one of my favorite New Testament books. 1 Peter 2 and 12 and 11 and 12 says this: "Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul." And then he says this: "Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us." And didn't Jesus say that we are the light of the world? In other words, we should shine in the darkness. People should take notice of us. And I would say without hesitation, the Christians who live dedicated lives, people will take notice of that. We will stand out. If we refuse to laugh at certain jokes, or if we just endeavor to live a dedicated life to God, then I believe literally also we will stand out. Their dedication to God was what got them noticed. There was a Christian apologist by the name of Francis Schaeffer. I remember reading one of his books many years ago, and I wish I did have the book in my hand just a while ago, but I believe it's in Mansfield. But Francis Schaeffer, he wrote a book called The Church Before a Watching World. The Church Before a Watching World. And, you know, I believe that no matter what situation we're going through, that, hey, that God is watching us. I believe that the angels are watching us as well. But I also believe in when we conduct our ways in certain ways, I believe that this world is watching us as well. And I wonder, what do they see? Do they see lives dedicated to God? Lives dedicated to God, I believe, stand out. Oh, I want to have, I don't know, I'm sure in speaking for us all, but I want a stand out life. I want to live a life so dedicated to God that those around me will take notice. And not to say how wonderful I am, but to say how wonderful the God is who has made me how I am. So their dedication was God was put to the test, just like our dedication to God will be put to the test. Their dedication to God was what got them noticed. And friends, that's what we want. We want for people to see that we've been with Jesus. We want people to see that we live according to a higher calling than this world. The third thing I want to say was that their dedication to God, it was not for sale. It was non-negotiable. Non-negotiable. You know the story, it's been read to you. Rumor got back to the king through little tattletales, as it were. You know these guys, they won't, didn't you say that once the music plays on their knees, they must go and bow down? And well, there's three people who you've elevated in your kingdom who refuse to do that. And so Nebuchadnezzar, almost obviously familiar with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, calls them into his presence. And if you read the story, it's almost like the king is trying to give them a second chance now. Okay, now, boys, you've let me down this time. I'm paraphrasing a little bit. You've let me down this time. But, you know, if you do it the second time, everything will be okay. And the king said, and if you don't, wow, it's the furnace for you. There's no other option, guys. What are you going to do? How did they respond to the king's threats? Actually, it's interesting to see here that they believed in the sovereignty of God. They believed that ultimately God was in control of the situation. But in verses 13, it says this, furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold I have set up? Now when you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, harp, pipes, all that, so on, you must fall down and worship. But if you do not worship, it's into the blazing furnace. And then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand. But even if he does not, you know, O king, we will not serve your gods. Oh boy, imagine saying that to the most powerful man in the world at that time. Wow, what pig-headedness of these guys. I just love it. How did they respond? Their backs were to the wall. They were in a straitjacket. I'm sure that was would have been very difficult to get out of. But you know, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. And the king says, "Look, bow or burn." But even with that, they said, "King, we're not doing it. We're not compromising our dedication to God. We cannot dishonor our God by bowing before an image. They would not budge. They were, to use an old expression, they were as stubborn as mules. I love their tenacity. God can save us, but even if he doesn't, our convictions are non-negotiable. Let me read something to you that I came across many years ago, but it really fits in with what I'm talking about. According to some sources, it was written by an African pastor who was martyred for his faith. And it goes like this. I am a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. I have the Holy Spirit power. The die has been cast. I have stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense. My future is secure. I am finished and done with low living, sight walking, small planning, smooth knees, colorless dreams, tame visions, worldly talking, cheap giving, and dwarf goals. I no longer need preeminence, prosperity, position, promotions, plaudits, or popularity. I don't have to be right, first, tops, recognized, praised, regarded, or rewarded. I now live by faith, lean on his presence, love by patience, lift up by prayer, and labor by power. My pace is set. My gait is fast. My goal is heaven, and my road is narrow. My way is rough, my companions few. My guide is reliable, my mission clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice, hesitate in the presence of adversity, negotiate at the table of the enemy, ponder at the pool of popularity, or meander in the maze of mediocrity. I won't give up, back up, let up, or shut up until I've preached up, prayed up, paid up, stored up, and spoken up for the cause of Christ. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I must go on until he returns. Give until I drop, preach until all know, and work until he stops me. And when he comes to get his own, he will have no problem recognizing me. My colors will be clear. Wow. Isn't that fantastic? The die has been cast. Oh, I tell you, for these three Hebrew boys, the die had been cast. There's no negotiation here. We won't be thwarted in living dedicated lives to our God. A great old Bible commentator by the name of Matthew Henry, commenting on these boys, said this. They resolve rather to die in their integrity than live in their iniquity. I like that. They resolved that they would rather die in their integrity than live in their iniquity. Their dedication to God was not for sale. We can't be bought, friends. We can't be bought. Last thing I want to say is this. Their dedication to God was how ultimately they got in the furnace. Sometimes, now, when we live a certain kind of lifestyle, sometimes it arouses the admiration of some people because we want them to be attracted to our Christian faith. But sometimes it doesn't always have that effect. In fact, I sometimes wonder why do we not persecute, or why are we not persecuted for our faith more in this country than what we see in other countries? I don't get that sometimes, you know. But sometimes, you know, if we don't toe the party line, we may end up in a furnace. People may ridicule us. People may resent us because we do not dance to the same tune. Friends, we don't dance to the same tune of this world. When the music plays, we don't fall down and worship the gods and the idols of this world. We dance to a different tune. And sometimes, you know, sometimes that can get us in a bit of trouble. Sometimes we can end up in the furnace. But ultimately, if we go into the furnace, hey, God will be there with us. He'll protect us. And even when we go through the fires, he'll be there for us. I read recently about a young American boy by the name of William Borden. About 150 years ago, he wanted to become a missionary in China. And on his way to China, he decided to go to Cairo in Egypt to learn Arabic for some reason. When he was there, he contracted spinal meningitis, I think it was, and sadly, he died. A young man, just at 25, you can go to his grave, apparently, in Cairo. But a scribbled note was found under his pillow a couple of days after his funeral. And on this scribbled note, it said this: "No reserve, no retreat, no regrets. No reserve, no retreat, no regrets." May that be true of us. Their dedication to God was what got them noticed. Their dedication to God was put to the test. Their dedication to God was not for sale. And their dedication to God was how they got themselves in the furnace. They did not bow. They did not budge. And guess what? They did not burn. Let me finish with how I began. Dedication is what you need. If you want to be the best, if you want to beat the rest, dedication is what you need. If you want to be the best and do the best for God, dedication is what you need. I love these Old Testament stories, don't you? They've got so much to tell us about the Christian life and how we conduct ourselves now. I just pray that these simple thoughts will be a blessing to you. Hey friends, I'm challenged. When I read these stories of these lives, it challenges me as well. Can we just pray? Thank you, Father, for these Old Testament stories of lives that were completely dedicated to you. We thank you for their inspiring example. And we ask you that in this world in which we live, that we'll stand out as people who are dedicated to their God. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Bless you all. Have a great day. Amen.
Well, thank you for that message, Dad. And let's make sure we take hold of those words, apply it to our lives, to live a life of dedication to the Lord. I'm going to hand over in a moment to Phil and Dawn Thompson, who are going to break bread. Before we do so, we're going to just sing a song of worship. See you soon.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the
today is to stay on fire. 1 John 5 verse 4 says this: "For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is victory that we have to overcome the world, even through our faith." Do you want a life to make, do you want your life to make an impact this morning or next year? You need to change the atmosphere of your home, the place of work, with a little enthusiasm. Choose to be happy. Live with excellence and integrity, and put a spring in your step. Put a smile on your face. Let the world know that you're enjoying the life that God has given you. When everyone else is down and defeated, when you are all alone and no one nearby, to encourage you, simply encourage yourself with the attitude that it should be, it doesn't matter what anyone else does or does not do. Say, I am going to have my life with joy, going to stay on fire for God. I'm going to be aglow with passion to see God work in our church and in our community, and for those that are lost and dying round about us. And if you should doubt the love of God for you, look what Jesus did on the cross. The cross shouts out love for you. God bless you all. I'll pass you to Phil.
Hello, everybody. We are living in uncertain times, living from day to day. But when we belong to Jesus, our Saviour, our time is set. We cannot sing in church, but we can sing in our homes as loud as we want. Praise God. As we are here today, and we're going to do the breaking of bread now. First, I'd like to read from Luke 22, verse 14 to 20. And it says, when the hour had come, he sat down with the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them, with fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me.
Thank you, Jesus.
Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, we come to you and we thank you, Lord, for looking after us, Lord, at this serious time. And Lord, we don't know, Lord, from one day to the next what will happen, but we know, Lord, that you are our future. And so, Lord, as we get on, Lord, with our lives, we pray thee, Lord, that your love will be surrounding us. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Dawn. Thank you, Phil, for breaking bread with us. And I want to thank everyone for dropping in this morning onto our online service, visitors, members alike. Also want to thank Dad, thank Kate for what they've brought to us as a church. Just to give you a few announcements of things that are happening over the next few weeks. This Tuesday night, we have our online Bible study and our Zoom prayer meeting. Please come along to the prayer meeting, guys. Be part of that. We're going to be praying just over the vision of the church and where things are going as a church. So let's pray. If you want to drop me an email at info@mpconline.org, and I can send you the details for that. That'll be really good. We have our online service again next Sunday morning at 10:45. Don't forget, folks, about the food, the Christmas food hamper. Please contact Kate on the number below. She is getting things organized. She's getting a few food hampers for various families that as a church that we are working with in this area. And I know up to now the response has been incredibly positive. So blessed to see and hear many different people just willing to give into this. So if you want to be part of that, please let Kate know and she'll pass you the details. Just also to inform you, church, Valerie Smith's funeral, we have a date for that. It's going to be on Tuesday, the 1st of December at 1 p.m. If you want to attend that funeral, we have a limited space of up to 30 people. So if you want to come along to that, please give David a ring and tell him who in your home or household is coming. We'll get a seating plan arranged for that. And it'll be good to see you, to be part of that. You know, Valerie was such a faithful lady soul in this church. She was part of the church since she was 3 years of age. That's incredible, isn't it? And, you know, a quiet lady, but such a real blessing to this church and to God's people. And it'd be great just to honor her memory. So if you want to come along to that funeral, Tuesday the 1st of December at 1 p.m., please give David a ring and we'll get you a slot booked in for that. Hey, listen, thank you for being part of our time this morning together in our worship experience. Hope you've enjoyed this time. Pray God's richest blessing upon you. Hope to see you soon and have a great rest of the week. Bye.
I'm not a warrior. I'm too afraid to lose. Qualified for what you're calling me to. Lord, with your strength, I got no excuse. 'Cause broken people are exactly who you use. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Shepherd boy and made him a king. So I'm gonna trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror 'cause you fight for me. Shake the wall, won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus, I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. Yeah! Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. My giant.